Good evening and welcome to McNeil and Robinson Booksellers. I would just like to begin by acknowledging that we are in Treaty 1 territory and that the land of which we gather is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Oji-Cree, Cree, Dakota, Dene peoples, and the homeland of the Métis Nation. My name is Kobe, and on behalf of the store and with thanks to the Winnipeg Labour Council, it is my pleasure to welcome you here tonight to the Winnipeg launch of No Shortcuts, Organizing for Power in the New Gilded Age by Jane McAlevey. Here to introduce Dr. McAlevey, please join me in welcoming Bronwyn Dobchuk Bund.
Thanks very much. Thank you everyone for being here tonight. Oh, I shouldn't have touched that. Okay, there we go. My name is Bronwyn Dobchuk Bund. I'm one of the members of the Winnipeg Labour Council Education Committee that has organized Jane's visit to Winnipeg. This book launch is the last event in a series of, we put Jane to work hard here in Winnipeg, consultations, and an event last night. Last night, Jane gave a really rousing talk at the library, and I've seen and heard many murmurings about how inspiring it was for many people in the audience. So I believe that talk is actually gonna be online at some point. Yeah, awesome. So stay tuned for that if you weren't able to make it last night. We're so lucky to have Jane in Winnipeg. As she will tell you, and as you will read about in her book, the methods and practices of organizing that she has to share with us have long histories. She didn't invent them. However, she is an exceptional teacher of these methods. And she speaks from a wealth of experience over a long period of time, practicing these methods and winning with them. And that's what makes hearing her talk, I think, so exciting and inspiring. In addition to her experience, the book that we're talking about tonight reflects her systematic study of what successful organizing looks like across a number of winning cases. So Jane was an organizer for a long time, community labor organizer, wrote a book right as she was starting her PhD program, which was really intimidating to those of us. I should also mention, Jane and I were in the same PhD program at the City University of York Convention Center. so yeah, we were, you know, starting out first year PhD. Jane has a book out already. Yeah, no big deal. But
she was like 12, by the way, and like kicking my butt in statistics and everything else. And I was like, who is she?
Yeah, that was problem.
Yeah. Yeah, I was the impressive one. anyway, so in Jane's first book, it's much more story-like. This is a repetition from last night. This book reflects study during the course of her PhD in sociology at the City University of New York Graduate Center. And most recently, also, Jane held a position as a postdoctoral fellow at the Harvard Law School in the trade union program. So she's continued to do studying, teaching, and also learning through practice. So she continues to organize, which is also unique for academics. so we have so much to learn from her and the tradition that she comes from. Tonight in Q&A format, David Camfield, professor of labor studies and sociology at University of Manitoba, will ask Jane some questions that'll kind of scratch the surface of these lessons. Then we'll open up the floor to questions from the audience, and then I hope that we all buy Jane's book, read it together, and continue to think about the implications of these lessons for building power in Winnipeg for radical transformative social change. I will just also quickly thank the many sponsors that made Jane's visit here possible. And I'm just gonna list them. You can like shout if you're from one of these organizations if you want. Amalgamated Transit Union, 1505, yeah. Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives, Canadian Labor Congress, Canadian Office and Professional Employees Local 342, QP 500, Canadian Union of Postal Workers, Manitoba Government and General Employees Union, all right, Manitoba Teachers Society, this is fun, Public Service Alliance Canada, Solidarity Winnipeg, United Food and Commercial Workers, Local 832, Unifor Local 7, 830, and 3003, University of Manitoba Faculty Association, Workers United, and thank you to High Tech for the posters, donation in kind for the posters. Anyway, without further ado, let's get to talking about this book. Thanks very much again to the audience and to Jane for being here.
So Bronwyn and I have come up with some questions which we'll use to get the discussion going. And the first one, Jane, is that your book distinguishes between advocacy, mobilizing, and organizing. Could you explain what you mean by those three terms?
I think that's my favorite topic. Is that right? I'm trying to like figure out how I look at David, thank Bronwyn, look at this guy, and see all of you. Part of what I was trying to address in No Shortcuts was primarily what I see as mass confusion about what the word organizing means. There became a point in my life where everywhere I went, whether I was in a trade union setting or an environmental setting or a community-based organizing setting, where people said, we're organizing. And I was like, really? Doesn't look that way to me. But I didn't say that because that's rude. But I kept thinking about it. Like, I kept hearing it was like everybody was organizing. And I thought, I wanted to devote some time to actually helping people understand what organizing really means versus what mobilizing is versus what advocacy is. And there's even a fourth one, which I think most people understand the distinction, which is charity, right? I mean, if you think about like potential, the ways people think about change or the change process or how to make improvements in some people's lives. At the sort of least change, least transformative level of sort of just straight charity. And we need straight charity sometimes, right? Like there are moments, whether it's a flood, a storm, a migrant moment, something, when we all need some charity, so that's okay. But I don't think people think that charity is particularly transformative, but it's sometimes urgently needed. Then there's advocacy, and so for me, the place where people begin to get confused about what it is we're doing and what it might lead to really starts at the advocacy rung. So advocacy I wanted to try and define carefully as sort of what it says in the name, which is like people advocating on behalf of other people. And I think in advocacy it's pretty clear. There's lots of organizations. I mentioned some last night. I can mention them again. But any organization that we write a check to advocate in government or somewhere on our behalf, where there's no actual involvement by ordinary people, is sort of what advocacy is. And in the book, I outline sort of theory of power and sort of mechanism of how the change happens. I go through a series of charts about what this means. But so advocacy, you write a check, you pay some lawyers, you pay some pollsters, and some people are hired and somewhere they're just off trying to lobby a bill in your provincial capital or in your federal capital or something like that. But there's no pretense that anyone's actually being involved in it. So that's advocacy. And I think it can make some gains, some of which are even good. There's lots of lawyers involved, there's lots of public relations people involved. And not all things that advocates do is bad, by the way. We just need to be clear what it is, which is it's actually not teaching anyone how to actually make transformational change in their own lives. And then the point of real confusion for me, and what I say is my obsession in the book, and it is a bit my obsession, is that I think in the last 25 years or so, certainly in the trade union sector in the United States, which is most of what I was looking at, I think what got perfected was something called mobilizing. And it was dressed up as organizing. In fact, it wasn't just dressed up, it was like called the organizing model. And what I say was actually not organizing at all. But every mobilization that people were involved in was somehow just labeled organizing. If you called it organizing, people thought it was organizing. So to me, the core distinction is that mobilizing is not what I think really matters, which is what I call base expansion. Like, how do we expand the universe of people involved in identifying with the idea of progressive social change? So mobilizing relies on staff, They may not be professional lawyers or professional pollsters where they are in the advocacy model. They might even call themselves organizers, which is what gets really confusing out in the world. Like many people who say, I'm an organizer, when I get deep into that discussion, actually, no, you're not an organizer. You're a mobilizer in my mind, because what you're doing is you're not changing the hearts and minds. You're not helping people themselves come to a transformative moment where they realize, these are the bad people, these are the forces of good, this is where I'm going to stand for the rest of my life and fight. That's what organizing is. Organizing is getting people who are not involved in our movement, who don't self-identify as being involved in a movement, and helping them come to their own conclusion, which is a super important concept, like helping people come to their own conclusions about what's right and what's wrong in the world, and about who's making their lives miserable, and what the solution is to get out of having a, unfortunately, sometimes miserable state of being, having your pensions taken away, whatever is happening, right? So mobilizing is a staff-centric model. It was perfected in a handful of unions in the US in the last 25 years, and not just the unions. But what upset me as a trade union organizer was I left one set of organizations in the United States when I began to do full-time trade union work, expecting that I was going to find this thing called organizing sort of everywhere, just because people were saying we were doing it. And then I realized that slowly the mobilizing model was seeping into the trade union sector. And workers, as central actors in their own liberation, were being replaced by professional full-time staff who were functionally advocating on their behalf in state capitals, at the bargaining table, you know, fill in the blank. So I began to realize that the mobilizing model, it involves people, so it seems like organizing. We have protests, so it seems like we're organizing, because we have flags and strike flags come out and signs come out, and it sounds like we're actually doing organizing, but the truth is, all we're doing is it's a bunch of staff essentially doing turnout, like endless turnout, of largely the same people over and over and over. And I jokingly say in the chart at the beginning of the book, and when they get exhausted because all they do is turn out and turn out and turn out and things don't seem to change, we just burn out thousands of people and start again and get a whole bunch of people who already agree with us, who turn out and turn out and turn out until they burn out. And there's nothing additive about the model because it's not fundamentally helping people see where the forces of good are and where the forces of, for lack of a better word, evil are. So for me, the organizing model vests and rests, the sort of the ability for the change to happen has to be vested in ordinary people, not full-time professionals. And it's a really clear distinction, and it relies on a sort of mass-based theory of change, which, of course, I identify as class struggle, fundamentally, in the book.
So I'm going to take this now to Manitoba in a second, because here, I think, in a lot of other places too, there's a really stark divide between union activism on the one hand and community activism on the other, outside of unions. And I think one of the most compelling aspects of your organizing and the cases that you document in the book, the new one, is the successes that come from rooting labor struggles in broader community concerns. So could you talk about your concept of whole worker organizing and your vision for integrating labor and other social movements?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for being here, all of you. Sometimes I feel like this gets interpreted as a source of tension occasionally with some people in the community sector, which to me is a bit, it's just interesting. And I've had the debate in the US with several longtime allied organizations who are in the community organizing sector, who I think misinterpret some of what I'm describing when I talk about whole worker organizing. It's certainly not about supplanting any existing organizations. It's about making a more effective movement. There's several things that I believe. One is the real organizing tradition, the class struggle tradition that I was trained in the union I came out of, which is called 1199 New England, a very specific union. So the class struggle theory of power that we had, which was ultimately workers have to be able to create a crisis for capital. Like that's what I was taught as a young organizer. If workers themselves can't create a crisis for the corporation that they're working for or for capital generally, then their ability to make change is quite limited. So, you know, from day one, it was like, can workers here create a crisis? And creating a crisis, in my training, means you're walking off the job. So at the end of the day, What I came to realize when I shifted my full-time work from environmental justice organizing, community-based organizing, came into the trade union sector full-time, I thought, wow, the truth is, workers' ability to strike en masse and walk off the job is a hell of a lot more power than anything else I've ever been involved in. And I've been involved in some terrific struggles, you know, forcing toxic polluting companies either to shut down, or if the decision was we don't want them to shut down because we want the jobs, to radically transform the production process, like things that were challenging the production process in the US in pretty profound ways. So some pretty big fights, some pretty good change in the environmental justice movement when I was a young organizer. Using a lot of the same mechanisms and tools, like people themselves had to be at the center of different kind of disruptive actions that we were taking. But still, there was nothing quite like the power of a serious strike. There is nothing like the power of a serious strike, in my opinion. So I started to think to myself, well, if a union has the potential, still in 2017, here and elsewhere, if still in a theory of change, a union has the most potential to be the most powerful potential source of change in ordinary workers' lives, why is it that we just see workers as workers in the trade union sector? Why is it that we don't see workers as whole people? Because I started in the community organizing sector working with working class people, I was astutely aware of all of the many challenges that working class people had when they weren't at work. So it was like this weird, bizarre thing to me to come into the trade union sector and literally be told early on, when some workers came in with a housing crisis in their lives, to be told by four important, love them all now, but we struggled mightily then, but to be told by four powerful trade union leaders, okay, McAlevey, like you stop that housing fight thing, because that is not a trade union issue. Like, affordable housing is not a trade union issue. And I was, I have to tell you, this struck me as like, you know, I wanted to put an ice pick through my brain. I was like, okay, wait a minute, we just want a $2 an hour raise in contract negotiations for super low-wage workers whose housing is being torn down by a rich gentrifying mayor with a bunch of corporations behind him. And so they're gonna start driving 2 hours a day to get to work. Their housing costs are gonna go up. It's gonna sink whatever raise we just won in the contract at work. And you're all flipping crazy if you don't think this is a labor issue. Like it just, it was just uncomfortably bizarre to me. That we had this neat divide that only things that had to do with workplace issues and wages and hours, you know, like the things that literally define what's a mandatory subject of bargaining is like how we've come to define our work life as a trade union movement. And, you know, I can get into like what's prohibitive subject of bargaining, what's mandatory, what's permissive. We can get into a big discussion about negotiations, but I was like, that just frames what we're doing in the negotiations room. That shouldn't frame our imagination as a working class labor movement. So so I began almost from my first, I think my third month in to being a full-time staff person, full-time paid organizer as a trade union organizer, I began to get into very difficult, sometimes very uncomfortable battles with the union leadership that I was working with, who I have had a lot of respect for, and I think that mattered. And I think I'm not sure where I've mentioned it now, somewhere in Manitoba, somewhere in Winnipeg in the last 24 hours. You know, I've talked very honestly about the struggles I had with trade union leaders to sort of say, at some point early on, because we had already won two big organizing campaigns, like I was hired to help, you know, a lot of workers try and win a bunch of campaigns. And I think only because we straight off won a couple of campaigns early on, did I get away with essentially the equivalent of like standing on a chair basically in a meeting with four trade union leaders and saying, I quit. Like I'm quitting, I just quit, I'm out of this campaign. If you don't let us do work with the same members who we just won contracts with on the housing fight, I'm just quitting. That was a sort of transformative moment in my relationship with them because they decided it probably wasn't worth letting me quit right then. And so we began to slowly nurture our way into what seemed like a very natural organic fight to me, which was a fight for affordable housing and against gentrification. What soon thereafter happened was we were winning a ton of union organizing campaigns. We began to win really good first contracts because they were new organizing campaigns. We began to win really strong, like strong meaning good, like real, what we consider, I don't know if everyone has these rubrics, but in the unions I was working with, we had an A level, a B level, and a C level contract. And an A level is like, you get the health care, in our crazy country, the United States, you have to negotiate for healthcare. Okay, so, you know, an A-level contract means, you know, you've won a really good healthcare plan where the workers don't pay anything. You've established the rubric of a real pension plan, a real retirement plan. Workers have won really good sort of workplace rights, grievance, you know, so it's a high-level standard contract. And then we have a B-level contract and a C-level. And in the universe of our thinking, you usually win a C-level contract in the first contract, then in the next contract you might win a B-level contract if the workers are in really good shape, and then you might win an A-level contract in the third contract, and then you just fight to keep that, right? That's sort of the, and what we were doing off the back of this housing campaign was we were building so much community support, so much deep community support for the trade unions through the housing campaign, that all the union leaders began to realize that we were starting to win A-level contracts in our first contracts. Because when we asked people to come out and support the workers, it wasn't like 10 people dribbled in to support the workers. It was like a big African-American church would host a meeting to condemn a boss, and 1,000 parishioners would show up to condemn the CEO locally. And then they would call on the mayor, you know, and then all the black ministers would get together and they would call on the mayor of the city to condemn the CEO and revoke their zoning privileges or their part. I mean, it was suddenly we were exercising wicked amounts of power. And that wicked amount of power that we were exercising was in fact because we had begun to do something called a worker organizing, which meant we were integrating the deep issues that working class workers face at work and when they went home. And it's that integration that to me is essential. Like, if we're gonna build powerful movements again, it's essential. So it's certainly in my work life, it's never stopped. Like every time I'm doing what we think of as sort of straight up union organizing, I'm absolutely immediately incorporating what are the set of issues that matter to the workers around here when they punch the clock and they go home. And again, it doesn't mean that we don't need freestanding, independent, community-based groups of all kinds. It just means that we're gonna bring way more power to the fight traditionally than a lot of freestanding community-based groups have. We need them, there's lots of issues, there's a ton of work to do, but remarkably, given how weak a lot of unions feel, I think, to all of us, right? It's like a terrible feeling to me, watching the power of unions recede globally. But even in the US, where we're like knocked on our butt right now, you know, we're just hanging on by a thread, we're still the most powerful institution that working class people in our country have. So to me, the idea of separating a worker's issue is only defined by the union contract from all the other things coming down on them in their lives, which have a lot to do with gentrification, poverty, racism, sexism. I mean, there's just a huge set of issues that bear down on workers at work and at home. And I think when unions address all those issues, we build a kind of movement, that's the exact kind of movement that we need right now to stop the madness that's taking place.
So, you know, here in Manitoba, we have a pretty right-wing provincial government, you know this.
Brian,
yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. But there hasn't been that much protest against what this government has been doing. And in response to this, some people say that working class people are apathetic and there's really no point trying to organize against austerity. So how would you respond to that?
I get to invoke, and again, if I embarrass him, then he can disown me later, but I was having this nice conversation with Alex earlier today, and we were discussing one important idea that's relevant to this question, which is, I have to say as an organizer that when people tell me that the reason that workers aren't coming out to something is because they're apathetic, my immediate reaction is actually it's our failure. Like that's actually institutional failure because people are really angry. People are really overwhelmed by a lot of issues in their lives. They'd love to figure out how to do something about it. And the truth is, you know, I think I was making this point yesterday, but not even just in the trade union context, but just in general. Our primary school systems, not the fault of the teachers for sure, but our primary school curriculum and educational systems are not putting a serious priority on, like, how does democracy actually really work? Yeah. Not you go to the polls and vote, right? But, like, how does democracy actually really work? How do corporations and capital control the political system? That's a pretty serious thing to try and fit. It took me a long time to figure out, like, how is it that corporations have come to control governments and seize control? What does economic concentration have to do with political concentration? How does power actually work? We are not teaching people how power actually works. And so to think that the ordinary person is going to just respond and show up for every protest, which largely feels like a waste of time because they don't see it doing anything, is the reason why people stay home. And part of what I say, I think, really clearly in Raising Expectations in the first book, is that when we actually do the work that the full-time folks should be doing, which is enabling people to participate really meaningfully in the change process, I have never not had people show up in big numbers. And it can be little things and it can be big things. We tend to run meetings poorly. Would you say that? We tend to run meetings really poorly. And the idea of a well-run meeting versus a poorly run meeting seems so basic. In fact, since you're in the academic arena and Brahman introduced me and outed me as playing in that arena the last few years, the amount of times I've said to serious academics, unnamed for this purpose, but at CUNY or elsewhere, when they say, you know, people are just apathetic, I say, if I ever came to a meeting, fill in the blank, that any of you ran, I would never come to a meeting again. Like, a horribly run meeting is just painful, right? The truth is, we're all busy. And the more working class you are, the more busy that you are. You've got kids to attend to. You've got a spouse, potentially. You've got an after-school program. You've got a million things to do in your life. So I always say, when the work and the cause and the participation become meaningful to people, they show up in droves. And in Stanford, in the very first campaign I ran, where we did the big housing fight, I felt like I kept thinking it's such a low bar. What's considered doing good work seems to be such a low bar to me, because so many academics started flooding in to study the campaign, because we were winning all these things, right? And suddenly all these academics, I didn't even know who they are, like, what are you doing? They're like, can we come study your campaign? You know, I was in my young 30s then. And I was like, sure, just stand out of our way, but do whatever you want here. And they were so excited, I didn't realize, like, oh my God, we were like, have the database, take the members, take the phone numbers, I don't care, like, go talk to people, great. So that was apparently a very exciting thing. Now I realize after the PhD how exciting that apparently must have been. But anyway, they would ask questions like, why are people showing up at your meetings? You know, it's like this really, like, some big epiphany. And I'd be like, well, let's see. We have childcare that's really well run, so all the moms can come to the meetings. We've got really high quality food for babies and kids in the child care center. We're not just shoving a video into the machine. So first of all, we do really good child care. Second of all, we're translating every meeting simultaneously into Haitian Creole, Spanish, and English. You know, like the most basic things that allow for meaningful participation, like starts off, how do you do a good meeting? And then that carries into how do you do a good action? And then if people feel like if they can connect the action they're taking to actual victories, they'll show up every dang time we ask people to do something because they see it as their own action. So I think the idea that people are apathetic is a reflection of movement failure and that we have to think very hard about what is it that we're doing that's contributing to people not showing up, because it's certainly not that people are like sitting around thinking life is great right now.
No, I think, let me. But of course, we have to ask them to show up to something to start with. And I think one of the problems, you know, one of the issues, let me put it this way, in Manitoba is that for a lot of people, they think the focus is really simply the next provincial election. So that if we want to stop this government, really there's not much we can do in, you know, except for prepare for the election in 2020 and try to re-elect the new Democratic Party. So, would you like to share some thoughts about how to respond to that? Because that's a pretty important point of view out there.
Yeah. I just have to write a note down before I forget it, as you're talking to me about this. Yeah, sure. I think a few things about this. And again, I felt like I had amazing mentors. So many of the things that I now think are not like original thought. I just got to keep saying that. I had some amazing mentors. And one of them, on sort of the role of trade unions and or movements and politics, besides, I guess besides growing up in a very political household with a father who was a politician, who himself worked very effectively with the movement to like make sure protest was happening as it needed to happen. Aside from those sort of childhood reflections, by the time I got into the trade union movement, I was working initially for the national AFL-CIO, for like our CFL, right, the National Trade Union Confederation. My first paid work was as a national senior organizer for the national AFL-CIO. And certainly down in Washington, D.C., in our big national headquarters that I would have to fly into fairly often for national meetings, we were tethered, strongly tethered, to the National Democratic Party in the United States. And I quickly began to learn that it was not okay with my higher-ups if I suggested that we needed to do some serious actions against members of the Democratic Party, let alone primary them, like actually run. I like to run rank-and-file trade union members against what I call bad Democrats, which I outline as a target-rich environment in my first book, because most members of the Democratic Party of the United States would just sell out corporate lackeys at this point. So, I digress. Did y'all see the news? Did you actually see the news that they've now admitted how the Democratic Party completely sabotaged Bernie Sanders? Like, that's broken today and yesterday. Not that we didn't know that, but, you know, then the evidence finally comes out. Anyway, I digress from the party. But so, Jerry Brown, who was certainly one of my central mentors, not the governor of California, but the head of 1199 New England, which is the union that trained me in a lot of trade union fundamentals. Jerry had a very different philosophy about the relationship between the union and movements generally, but our union, the union I was working for and a member of. He had a very clear philosophy about the relationship between protest and what it meant to hold our own party accountable to our needs. So Jerry would always say, the minute we elect somebody, like the minute we elect somebody, and we did really good, we were considered the most effective political union in the state of Connecticut, which is where, and Rhode Island, but I was mostly anchored in the state of Connecticut. So, you know, if you read a magazine or any studies about the state, our union was considered the most effective political organization in the state, bar none. You know, if we went out to like take someone out of office or put someone in office, we pretty much did it. Why? Because we had a really high participation union that ran strikes all the time. So members were really involved. But I digress, but there's a relationship, of course. But so we would elect somebody and Jerry would call a meeting and say, what's the first protest we're taking against the person we just elected? What's the first thing that they do wrong that we're gonna kick their ass for in public? And it was always like, wow. And he's like, you gotta teach them a lesson the minute you put them in office, McAlevey. So I tell that story as a metaphor for a different approach to politics, which is the more that they're our party, the more obliged we are to hold them accountable to what we put them in office to do. And what I heard, yeah, Jerry, we really did it. And it was, you know, we were always considered somewhat controversial in the broader labor community in that state too, because, you know, most other people, the politician would call them and say, hey man, I'm your friend. Like, don't you show up at that protest today. And we'd just be there like, strike flags waving and take them on. And I definitely believe in and adopted that basic philosophy, which is our relationship to our party is not that we put them in office and then do what they tell us to do. We put them in office because we tell them what they have to do next. I really think that we err a lot by not doing that. I think that when we put them in and we think they have more power than us now, you know, and I was leadership enough in the trade union movement in the US that I had plenty of my own experience with this. You know, in Nevada, certainly, when I was the executive director of a big union that was winning a lot of political races and we were knocking out a lot of bad Democrats. What I loved to do was run our own rank and filers all the time, right? We just created a farm team of like rank and file workers from our unions who were gonna run against bad Democrats. And certainly in Raising Expectations, I believe it might be chapter 3, where I tell a story for which I'm still being politically punished, so I might as well tell it again. Dear Anna, I'm kidding. But it's true, I'm being politically punished still for a chapter in my first book, where I talk about when I, with the full support of several local unions and SEIU, made a decision that we wanted to run some rank and file trade unionists against a very corporatist Democrat. You know, I was essentially banished from the eastern region of the United States by a top vice president of the union for the simple act of running actual rank and file trade union members from our union through a democratic process in the union against a sitting Democrat who apparently had some ties to our executive vice president of the national union. And it was as fast as a series of phone calls were made, and I was literally banished from the eastern region of the United States, and that was a pretty special moment. So, you know, it's a very complicated relationship that labor has developed. I can't speak to your country, I can only speak to mine. I know that there are some similarities, but I hold the value of challenging the ethic that once we elect them, we don't touch them, and they tell us what to do, not we tell them what to do. I take that so seriously that I was willing to get banished from the eastern region of the United States, you know, and banished to the west, which was like, that's bad punishment. That's like being banished to a great city or something. But anyway, So I want to go on Jerry Brown's logic. I want to say that we make a huge mistake when we do a lot of work to elect someone, and then we stand our troops down. And then the lesson we teach them is all wrong, because we don't know how to do governance very well. I just think that we've had so little power in contemporary times that we haven't been able to be very effective as a movement with what does the governance period look like once we run the election. And I think we have to be more active, not less active, in the governing period than we even were in the campaigns.
That's very interesting given the experience in Manitoba. From a different angle though, there are people who say essentially that faced with an austerity government, there's nothing we can do except electoral preparations, right? That in terms of any kind of organizing, taking an organizing strategy, putting it into practice vis-a-vis the sitting provincial right-wing government is basically a dead end.
Yeah.
And that really people should just prepare and invest in preparations for the election. Can you say something about the question of...
Strike the state! Okay, sorry. yes. I mean, first of all, I do want to say I've already met a lot of good people here, not just David, but Basha and many, and go transit and go UMFA and whatever. Everyone I've met in the last 2 days, like it's pretty exciting. I think there's a lot of good work happening here. So, and I don't pretend to know your context specifically, so I can just relate to my own stories and how I think about this. I'm working on a third book right now called Striking Back. And it's because I believe that the general surrendering of the strike weapon has definitely led us in part to the place that we are at in the United States and in a lot of countries right now, which is a bad place, where the austerity, the wheels of austerity have just been mowing us down for a few decades. There's so much literature. What was so interesting for me to go from basically 30 years of organizing into the academy was like reading the academic rationale for why strikes aren't happening, and you know all these things are sort of like, okay, whatever. And that strikes can't happen. Like I've read so many things that we just can't strike anymore. And of course that flies in the face of the really obvious fact that a bunch of unions are still striking, and I want to congratulate UMFA. It might even be your union. Am I saying that right?
UMFA? Yeah, UMFA.
Okay, yeah. I want to congratulate the workers who went on an open-ended strike in 2016, because I think that's the kind of activity that we have to do a whole lot more of, and a lot more. And the British Columbia Teachers Union, which is who inspired the Chicago Teachers Union, which is like was a little-known fact, even when I went in to like do research on the Chicago Teachers Union strike of 2012, and I began to realize, oh, they learned. They got their moxie up from the illegal strike that was run in British Columbia. So a lot of strikes are going to have to be illegal because, in fact, capital controls the state in most places, last I looked. So of course they admit it so that strikes are not legal. And if in the 1930s in the United States, in the working class movement, we decided that following the law was going to be a super important thing to do, we would never have had any of the gains that we won. And if in the civil rights movement in the United States South, when black people were trying to get out of a legal structure that was completely oppressive, if people thought following the law was what was important, we would never have made any of the gains, which Trump would like to roll all back now to like 1920, but anyway, and we would never have made any of the gains. So there are a lot of times when we need to be ready to break the law. or we're going to lose the whole country. You're going to lose your healthcare system. We're going to lose a lot. We're already losing a lot. So it doesn't mean that all of it is possible. I remember getting to Nevada, just to be candid about it. When I got to Nevada, which is where I was hired by workers in a union that was in a lot of trouble, to try and help teach workers to rebuild a strong and mighty union, which we did in an open shop state. When I began, like the first time I thought, oh, we just need to take the public health care workers out on strike. And we had a very good legal team, like outside law firm who I had brought in when I came in, a very progressive, radical law firm. So I trusted the law firm to, like, they understood that their job of the lawyers in that moment was to enable people to do things and then get us out of trouble, not to constrain us.
Yeah.
No to lawyers. I actually remember sitting down with a lawyer I'd worked with for many years and saying, what are the consequences if we strike? And he said, $100,000 a day, jail time. You know, it was like the most egregious anti-strike law that we had ever sat down to read together. So that would not have been a casual one, right? So what we did do was we began to lead strikes in the private sector side of the union. So to me, there's always a way around it. Like, I thought, okay, well, we're definitely not going to strike the first unit that I thought we might strike because the rules of the game were super insane, like more insane than almost any state in the country. But the laws were not the same in the private sector. So it was like, great, we're going to be able to have a lot of strikes in the private sector of the same union. So I think the more we can coordinate our activity, you know, it sounds so simple, coordination, labor solidarity, you know, all that stuff. And I know that people here, like Bosch's presence in the Labour Council now is going to be he's going to take everyone to try and make change. But the weird simple lesson is that when unions do the old-fashioned thing called deep solidarity, like when we actually team up together, in almost every scenario we win, because we have a ton of power. So the question is, how do we do it? And how do we see, what's the relationship that we understand between strikes and state action? And I think it's pretty profound. My second or third year as a trade union organizer full-time, still back in my first local, 1199, Jared Brown, the one who said, you know, we have to immediately punish everyone that we put in office just to teach them a lesson, he decided that austerity was coming in the state of Connecticut, and to make a long story short, of course it's in the first book, the decision was that we were going to run the largest strike by nursing home workers ever in American history, which was 78 nursing homes at once. And it took us a significant amount of time to line up all the contracts, like the basics of how do you line up all contracts in a geographic market so that the power of labor is maximized. I would encourage that as a first project, or maybe the third, I don't know, a fifth project of the Winnipeg Labour Council. Very hard to do, but actually figuring out, like, how do unions get back on the program of aligning our contract expirations?
Alistair's doing it for us.
Woo!
You
know? Yeah, but like, how can unions decide, how can workers inside of unions enable, politely, their leadership to figure out that lining up contract expirations is fundamental so that we can get back to, oh, what was it, the 1919, what was that big strike that you just had a monument for? Oh, that, yeah. So, you know, lining up contracts is this really, really basic idea so that if the collective agreements expire within a few months of each other, even just in the same year, unions can actually decide to create a crisis for the state, which is called having pretty big strikes again. And all the strikes that I write about in No Shortcuts, and certainly the Chicago Teachers Union strike, was an example of you're coming after us, we're going to throw down with everything we have. And in the state of Illinois, it's so instructive. And I have to write about this because I haven't, and I keep waiting. You know, as a writer, it's like I keep waiting for someone else to write things that need to be written, and then when they don't write them, I get annoyed, and so I have to write. So I think I'm on the verge of doing some writing again, just some articles, because in the state of Illinois, which is where, you know, Chicago is, and where those teachers had such a mighty strike, the governor who was elected came in to do to the state of Illinois, to the workers and the working class in the state of Illinois, what had happened in Wisconsin, what had happened in Michigan. So like the Midwestern former union strong states were just being rolled by right-wing governors moving an austerity agenda and taking away basic working class rights and destroying unions. And in Illinois, because the governor came in a complicated state, came into an election after the Chicago teacher strike had really, really transformed 400,000 parents, 180,000 students, basically the third largest city in the country, was transformed by one mighty strike. That state and that right-wing governor, billionaire that he is, has yet to be able to change one single law against workers in Illinois. And that's an incredible story about challenging the state. It's just incredible. And I keep waiting for someone to write the article connecting the dots to, like, you know, why did the workers and unions get rolled in Iowa, now it's Iowa, and Michigan, and Wisconsin, and why in Illinois does it look different? It looks different because there was a massive strike, and it was successful, and it literally was a transformative strike for the whole of the city of Chicago, and people began to understand what it meant to exercise power again, as even against a strong governor. So, I think we need a lot of strikes, and I don't think it's as hard as we think, and some people here are figuring out already how to do it.
Okay, thank you. We've got time to have a few questions or comments from the folks in the audience here. So what I'm going to do, I'll take a speaker's list, and I'm going to give priority to first-time people over anybody who would want to try to sneak in a second question or comment. And I'm going to try to keep it in an equitable way so it's not just men. And so if you just make, you know, a question or a comment fairly short and to the point to give opportunity to the most people to participate. Yeah, thanks.
All right. I'm actually going to kind of advertise what I'm doing. I'm lobbying against Uber in the city, and time is running out because Winnipeg is probably ramming the legislation through the province and the city faster than any other city in Canada. Not doing any research, not delaying, again, not like any other city in Canada. So I guess my question is about Uber and preventing, and then I guess after the damage is done, once they enter a city, maybe they'll follow.
Yeah,
we'll take a couple of questions and then Jane can come back on those. Yeah.
My question's about collective bargaining. Because collective bargaining seems it's the moment when members of a union come face to face with their potential power. And often it seems to me that that's also a scary time for many people, where the prospect of transformation is unnerving. And it would seem that unions have an obligation to demystify bargaining, hand bargaining over to members, perhaps, more than farm it out to experts, so-called experts, like, you know, outside the union, like a lawyer or a hired bargainer. But also, from your experience, what strategies work well to make people comfortable with power? Because to have power and to wield power is, for many people, an unusual thing to understand. Like, I have this power, I'm not used to this power, I've been told I don't have it, I do have it. Ah!
You've been in a lot of really high stress situations and working with people to get them through a lot of really high stress situations. How do you not crack, slash, if you crack, which you do, or how do you help other people get through that? Because it's a very emotionally, physically exhausting scenario, and I'm just wondering what kind of strategies you have to take care of the people you're working with, and yourself as well.
Yeah, sure.
Here's one.
So on Uber, to take them in order, on Uber, first of all, good work. Like, good work trying to shut them down. I wish everyone would, like, pull out their cell phones, and if they have that app on their phone, just, like, delete it right now. There is a way in which Uber has become, it boggles my mind in the United States. How many friends I have who, when I'm leaving a party late at night or whatever, something, which addresses the last question, but anyway, I'll come back to that, will be like, yeah, I'm just going to call you a car. And I'm like, the hell are you talking about? Call me a car. You know what I mean? First of all, walk, bike, hike, whatever. Okay, but you know, I'm freaked out often by how acceptable Uber has become, even among progressive activists in the United States. And I've taken to like getting into mini screaming matches instantly and threatening to crush people's telephones if they didn't delete the app. But that's only a personal approach to the question of Uber. So as a movement approach, I feel like, you know, I was just doing some work in London. I mean, I've been doing work with a bunch of British trade unions, United Kingdom workers, and they're actually beating Uber in London, and it's super exciting. And I was involved in it. I was leading a training for a few days, I think it's like 2 weeks ago now, in London, and much to my delight in the opening go-round of who was in the room were like the three workers who were lead plaintiffs in the actual lawsuit that is now keeping Uber constrained, at least, in the city of London. So I think like the first idea I would just have is, besides, it is something where it'd be great if the entire labor movement and every community organization and every anyone, you know, messaged as hard as we could right now, like it'd be a great thing to stop Uber from getting into Winnipeg. So I don't know how you do that, but at the local level, like what's the campaign look like to stop Uber in just this city would be huge. Every time we stop them, it's huge. And then learning from the power of how influential one speech was by the leader at the time of the British Columbia Federation of Teachers to the Chicago campaigns, the Chicago teachers, I feel like it'd be great to like pass the hat and buy a plane ticket for either one of the London Uber activists to get to Winnipeg really quickly to like rally people around the cause, and or one of the Seattle Uber teams. So there's two places in the world that I know who are beating Uber by actual activist means, and that's Seattle and that's London. So, I mean, I can't come to a whole strategy session about it, that'd be really fun, but I definitely support the idea that we need to stop Uber, and I think it'd be really great if we could stop Uber. And that'd be a nice project for people to focus on as well. So there's lots of means to do it. You know, it's the taxi drivers unions, complicated politics around some of it in both Seattle and in, like, do we want to organize them, or do we want to stop them, what do we want to do, right? There are some complicated strategy questions, but I think stopping the spread of the so-called gig economy companies as fast as we can is sort of urgent. So that's my encouragement to you and to everyone else is that Uber is pretty evil. And just the change in the guy at the top, you know, resigning is not the issue. The issue is that they're a dangerous cancer spreading around the world like Airbnb is. And Amazon, and fill in the blank, right? But it's a little bit too late to stop Amazon, that we could do other things to Amazon. I think it's not too late. Given that Uber is flat on its back from their own internal challenges, it's a great time to attack them. You know what I mean? Like, when the enemy is down, step on them. Sorry, like, that's actually something we have to do. And they're a little bit down right now. And so it's important to actually try and, you know, put some pressure on the neck while the beast called Uber is in trouble. So I want to support all of you doing that. And then on the question of collective bargaining, you know, that is one of my favorite topics. And I was talking a lot about that today with some people this morning here in Winnipeg. My basic shtick about negotiations is, off of what you said, is generally speaking, like under US law, and I think it's true here, under US labor law, when workers walk in, like literally walk into the negotiations room, it's the only place where they sit as legal equals to their employer. There is no other place under labor law where a worker sits as a legal equal. So to me, this is sort of like the housing fight when I first started working full-time for the labor movement in the way too far back, last century. It was so weird to me, I thought, well, if workers get to sit as legal equals when they're in the room called collective bargaining, why isn't everybody in here experiencing being a legal equal with their boss? And so, you know, began to bring as many people as possible into the negotiations process. Over the years, I also came to realize that because negotiations and contract negotiations is when workers will be the most interested in whatever is going on in their work lives in the labor movement, I essentially like short contracts like to be in negotiations as often as possible with as many workers as possible, and can gin up huge turnout for almost any political discussion. Any discussion that has to happen is going to happen in negotiations, in my opinion. So I see the art of negotiations as actually the art of organizing. Like, bargaining to me is organizing, fundamentally. If we call a meeting, not just because of what I said earlier, not just because most meetings are boring, but people have a lot to do, people are actually busy, right? So if you've got essentially what the employer, you know, what we call the employer war in an organizing campaign, a captive audience, to me in some ways, negotiations are like the good people's equivalent of where we have a bit of a captive audience. A bunch of workers will be given release time, or even if they're not, if they want to know what's going on in the contract, if we let them, they'll show up in very large numbers, right? Because we just traditionally don't let a lot of workers involved in the negotiations process. And when we do, they will show up in droves. That is a definite experience of mine. Anyone who saw some of the pictures I showed last night, I can just show endless pictures, you know, of when we actually treat all the members as serious grown-ups and involve them in the negotiations process, they come out in really large numbers. So everything from running the, like when I was describing earlier in Nevada, we began to run members against bad Democrats. We would launch our walk packs, like the political precinct walk, riding, walking pact, like the art of like launching a walk that we had to do to get a candidate elected. We would launch out of a negotiations caucus session. We would say to all workers, if you want to find out about even a big class grievance, you know, direct action around a grievance that's happening, you have to come into a meeting that's at 12 noon, it just happens to be we're having negotiations. If you want to do something with the political program, you have to come at 4 o'clock and we'll have the political director of the union armed with, you know, 100 walk packs with precincts and doors that have to be knocked, and that'll happen at the collective bargaining caucus room. So I just shift the entire functions of the union into the negotiations room in caucus time, because the participation rate shoots straight up in every single thing that we're doing in negotiations when we run negotiations as the generic sort of meetings of the union. And it's amazing when workers stand up. So to your point about fear, I think I showed at least one picture last night that had Samira Harris in it. She's just an incredibly powerful young nurse in Philadelphia. I remember so well last year in negotiations when they had formed their union and won, and we were in first contract negotiations. You know, and I believe in bringing as many workers as possible. And Samira actually had gotten elected to the negotiating team. So in the way I think about negotiations, you do two things. You elect a negotiations team, and there's a lot of mechanics to how we do the elections. I set minimum participation rates by department and unit before workers can elect their negotiator. So no less than 65% of workers in any given area, if it's a big facility, have to have filled in their contract surveys first, and not using any online tool. No online tools. Because if workers are learning to build a structure, they actually have to do hand-to-hand conversations about the survey and what they want in the contract. So we tether participation rates in negotiations right from the beginning. You can't elect a member from your division or class or unit until 65% of the workers in that area have actually filled in and participated in what they want from the contract. Once you meet a 65% threshold, then we'll open up nominations for the negotiations committee in that department, that unit, that workplace, and then someone will get elected. From day one we say the bargaining process has to be participatory, everyone has to be involved in it, and then someone like Samira, who was brand new in a first contract campaign. I think Samira was a 3-year nurse when she got elected to the negotiating team from her unit. And she had an incredibly moving speech one day in a meeting leading to negotiations about why young nurses were leaving her hospital. So I thought, that's great. How are we going to address that in the contract? So we wanted to make it so that no nurse could, in the whole first year of employment, be taken out of their unit for any reason, like a simple concept that they needed to be able to be left alone to learn their job in their home unit for 1 year. Because new nurses were coming in, and the boss would just like flip them down to the emergency department to like cover some emergency, and they'd be like freaking out. So Samira gave this impassioned speech in a meeting in front of a bunch of workers. So I, you know, said, you're going to do that in negotiations next week with the boss in the room. And She was like, oh, hell no. Oh, hell no. She was like, oh, no, I'm not. No, that's your job. You're the negotiator. And I was like, oh, yeah. I don't know a thing about what you just said because I'm actually not a nurse. So if you want to win on this, you're going to have to replicate that speech with the boss in the room. And this went back and forth and back and forth. And the picture I showed last night, I'm sure I showed one of them, of her standing up, because it was just a classically beautiful moment where when we started negotiations, and Samira just said no until the day of. Like, she just kept saying, no, I'm not going to do it. And I was like, all right, well, then I'm not going to do it either. So who cares about that article? Not me. I'm not going to work in the hospital. And of course, when push came to shove in that room, Samira stood up. When her coworker said to her, it'd be great if Samira Harris would talk about why young nurses are leaving. And fast forward, no more than 3 months later, so Samira Harris does it. We went some amazing language on new hires and protecting their time to learn and grow into their new jobs. And 3 months later, I'm gone from Philadelphia at this point. It's Martin Luther King holiday weekend. Trump is now, you know, coming into power. Terrible things are happening. Racism, you know, everywhere in, you know, from the White House, turning the country white from the White House. And I see a photograph from the Philadelphia newspaper, and the mayor of the city had Samira Harris kick off the first speech in front of a huge audience in downtown Philadelphia commemorating Martin Luther King. And I just started to cry. Like, it just made me cry. It was like, so, you know, the relationship between how workers learn to overcome their fear in a process that matters to them a lot, like negotiations, pivoted her into a top leader in the broader community in Philadelphia in a matter of months. And that is a long version of why we should open up negotiations and let workers take part in large numbers in actually determining what's in their contracts. And then to the question about how do we survive in the work. Yeah, I'm probably never the best person to ask that question to. I feel like you should ask all the organizers who worked with me that question. But I think it's not unlike the issue of apathy in some ways. Like, why do people decide to like skip dinner with the kids that night and come to something? Because they decide it matters. There's some relationship between our work too. I am definitely not a role model for like managing good hours or something like that, just to be super clear. I don't like to be macho in my old age about not sleeping, but I am personally lucky that I don't seem to need a lot of it, so that's helpful. I think that there are moments, like if you're talking about full-time people in the work, I guess it's two things. One is, what we're expecting of ordinary workers to do in campaigns is to work their tails off and make some sacrifices in a big campaign. Like, people are gonna miss dinner with the kids. They're gonna miss the soccer match on the weekend. Like, we're asking people to do a lot that's gonna affect their lives in a tough campaign. And so I feel like I'm not asking me or the professional staff team to do anything different, which is work really hard to win something. But I basically say to the sort of the full-time staff teams that I work with, as we approach an election or a strike or some really important moment, you probably need to like have a good conversation with your spouse if you have one, check in with the kids, and pretty much say you're not going to see them for a little while because it's going to take that kind of energy to win. And it just does. When people say to me, like, you know, what are some of the reasons why you think you were involved in, you know, a lot of winning campaigns, it's mostly because we think a lot about power analysis and how do you connect strategy to power. And my overall life argument, which is that if you haven't done good power analysis, you can't make good strategy, right? There's a lot of that goes into it. It's also a hell of a lot of hard work. And when I look at all the victories won by any serious campaign at any moment, anywhere in time, it took a hell of a lot of work. So I don't hire people and promise them that they're going to have a sane life in the middle of a campaign. I then do, though, to avoid burnout with full-timers, I'm really serious about breaking people. Breaking people means you're going to work for 45 days and probably not have a day off. And then I'm going to give you, if I'm in charge of the staff team, I'm literally going to say to every person who just put in hours like that in a tough campaign, hand me your phone, because people now are addicted to them. So I'm going to take a little box out. This is a real thing I've done many times. I'm going to walk up to young staff if they're young, or older staff if they're older, and say, okay, take your work cell phone out and put it in this box. That's good. Thanks. I'm going to disable it. And you're going to leave the office, and you're going to go take a break for a month, all on paid time. And you're just going to go, and I'm just going to send them away. And I literally send staff away, and I don't follow any rules or rhymes or reasons. I haven't had much of an issue with like collective bargaining issues with staff teams or anything, but and I think it's because I say to people, you're going to work your ass off, and I'm never asking someone to do more than I'm doing. Like, they're going to joke about who got the first email. Was it at 3:30 in the morning, 4 a.m., or 4:30 from me? Because I'm pretty much starting at that time in a big campaign, and I'm probably not going to go to bed until about midnight. And there's jokes about that. And I just think it's real. I just think when workers are working two full-time jobs to try and make ends meet, and then we want them to come to a protest or go on strike or do anything, we're asking a lot of people. And the process of change takes a lot. And I think it's deeply meaningful for everyone that I've ever been involved in doing it with them, whether it's the full-time staff or the working really hard rank-and-file members. Like, we're asking people to step up to make a big change. So for me, it's big, intense campaign moments and big breaks at a very personal level, and I've taught that. I've taught that to a lot of people who are in the movement full-time. I don't have, like, the burnout rate among people who work with me, I would say, is incredibly low. It's low to no. I mean, a few people have left, but not because they were burnt out, but because you have to take a big break. Like, it gets so super crazy, you have to take a big break. But I always say to people, this is not a 9-to-5 job. This is not a 9 to 7 o'clock job. This is a 5 a.m. to midnight job if we're on strike. This is a 24-hour job. This is ball-busting and totally exhilarating and absolutely satisfying and exhilarating work. And I always say, I cannot believe I get paid to do this. So that's my attitude about collecting a paycheck from workers, is that I'm going to work my ass off.
Now, since many people here would like to buy Jane's book and get it signed, I think this would be a good place to wrap. And if people can want to squeeze in a question, it would be, you know, time to do that one-on-one with Jane at the end. But thank you so much for coming and contributing to the discussion the way you have. And thank you, Jane. I think one of the things that really strikes me is that you, because of what you've lived, you have a sense of what's possible that so exceeds what most of us here have experienced. And I'm hoping it's going to be infectious and it'll help us, you know, as they say, be realistic, demand the impossible. I think we need to do a bit more of that in Manitoba. So thank you for, you know, inspiring us in that way.
I really do want to thank everyone who I've met in the last 24 hours. And I want to really honor that there is some tremendous work going on here. And I look forward to hearing about a lot more tremendous work going on here, and I want to thank all the unions that helped, and all the workers in the unions that helped to bring me here and take an interest in it, and David, you for thinking up thoughtful questions and giving up some of your time, and Bronwyn, and Alex, and Basha, and I think it's a long list, but I hope to be infectious, because we actually can win, and it's time to actually kick it up, because bad crap is coming unless people really do. So when is in Winnipeg? That's the most exciting thing. I look forward to hearing really good stories about what's happening in Winnipeg and Manitoba. Thanks.